LAESER, Nilas Benson, and the African and African Diaspora Studies Department are presenting this workshop or this panel about racial, the future of racial inequality, racial equality and ethnic equality in Latin America. So among so many things that is going on in our countries nowadays and so much uncertainties for our futures, and especially those of us who are Brazilian, we are really scared of what can happen after October 28th. So it's a good moment for us to get together and debate how we can construct not only research, but activism and even solidarity among we all, because we will need that in order to resist. So that said, our next panel is Comparative Racial Politics in Latin America. And as chair of this panel, we have Dr. Charles Hale. He is a Sarah Miller McCann Dean of Social Science at University of California, Santa Barbara. But we lent you to UC Santa Barbara, but you will always be UT, please. That's just temporary. Don't accept that title. Previously, he was a professor of African and African Diaspora Studies and Anthropology at the University of Texas at Austin and director of the Teresa Lozano Long Institute of Latin America Studies. He is known for his extensive work with Miskito, Creole and Garifuna peoples of Central America, on how societies transition from mono-ethnic governance toward the recognition of rights to autonomy, territory, and other forms of multicultural citizenship. Hale's research has been supported by funds from the National Science Foundation and the Ford, Werner Green, MacArthur, and Harry Frank Guggenheim Foundations. He was also awarded a Fulbright Fellowship for research and teaching in Oaxaca, Mexico. Then we have Dr. Tianna Paschel. Almost my show. Yeah, I think you guys are relatives. Yeah, Dr. Tianna Paschel is an associate professor in the Department of African American Studies at the University of California, Berkeley. Why so many people from Cali here? She is interested in the intersection of racial ideology, politics, and globalization in Latin America. She's the author of Becoming Black Political Subjects, which draws on ethnographic and archival methods to explore the shifting in the 90s from ideas of unmarked universal citizenship to multicultural citizenship regimes and the recognition of specific rights for Black populations by Latin American states. It is the winner of numerous awards, including the Herbert Jacob Book Award of the Law and Society Association and the Barrington Moore Book Award of the American Sociological Association, ASA. Professor Paschel is also the co-editor, along with Petra Rivera Rideau and Jennifer Jones, of Afro-Latinas, a movement and interdisciplinary volume that explored transnationalism and Blackness in the Americas. Dr. Paschel is a fourth fellow member of the American Political Science Association Task Force on Race and Class and Inequality, the Council of the Law Section of ASA, and the Steering Committee of the Network of Anti-Racist Action and Research, HIAR. Then we have Dr. Edwin Dorn, distinguished career features leadership positions in government, academia, and nonprofit research institution. A native of Houston, he graduated of Phi Beta Kappa from the University of Texas at Austin and completed his PhD in political science at Yale. He served as Dean of the Lyndon B. Johnson School of Public Affairs from 1997 to 2005. He asked me for not reading everything, but I don't know where to stop. Before he went to the LBJ School, he held leadership posts in federal government, working in Washington for 20 years. In 1993, he was confirmed by the Senate to serve as an Assistant Secretary of Defense. The following year, he was confirmed as the Undersecretary of Defense for Personnel and Readiness. Dr. Dorn is board member for several nonprofit organizations, including the Kettering Foundation and the Institute for Defense Analysis. He represents catering at meetings in Brazil, Russia, Morocco, and several other countries. At the LBJ School, he teaches seminar on race, immigration, and citizenship, and survey courses on defense police. His publications include Bruce and Racial Equality by Yale University Press and Who Defends America by the Joint Center Press. Please help me welcome our guest.
Daniela, thanks very much. The reason I ask Daniela not to read the entire bio is that the more one reads, the more apparent it becomes that I don't know diddly about Latin America. And so in my role as chair of this panel, I'm going to adopt the same type of strategy that I usually adopted when I testified before Congress, which is to hope that the other speakers and the members of the committee will get into a nice discussion, even better, a vigorous argument, and I don't have to say anything. With that in mind, I want to welcome Charles back many years ago when I was preparing for my first trip to Brazil. Charles allowed me to audit a course, a summer course in Portuguese, as a result of which I, for a brief period, felt competent to order coffee at almost any Starbucks in Brazil. And it's a pleasure to meet for the first time Tianna, Paschel. I am very sensitive to names, and so I asked her about the accent, whether the name was Paschel or Paschel, and so where does the accent fall? And she said both places. So it is Paschel. Charles, you're first on the list, so you get to go, and I get to play timekeeper. You have 20 minutes to be profound.
I better get started. Thank you to the organizers. I'm really honored and pleased to be back here. I'm not much of a nostalgic person, but I feel tingles coming into this building. These are not normal times. They confront us with multiple and to some extent conflicting imperatives. The imperative for action against resurgent white supremacy, racism, misogyny, and cruelty.
Thank you. That's probably better. The imperative for action against white supremacy, resurgent white supremacy, racism, misogyny, and cruelty. The imperative to resist normalization, the need for a modicum of self-care, collective self-care, care of our beloved communities, the need to prevent the paralysis of despair. We each have particular thresholds, conditions that will lead us to stop everything and declare a state of emergency and assume a stance of full-time resistance. In the meantime, it's very important to lay the groundwork for what is bound to be a long-term struggle. In academia, this means concerted institutional efforts to open and defend space for ethically and politically engaged scholarship, teaching, and service. I'm very grateful to have worked here for 22 years with many of you in a setting that allowed and in some cases actively nurtured those very commitments. This stance is not partisan. It's grounded in the values of independent, pluralist, and scholarly rigor, infused with and enabled by institutionalized principles of intersectional equity and social justice. If we in higher education waver in our courage and conviction to defend these principles, we risk losing everything. This brings me to LAESER. I'm proud to have been present for the recruitment of Professor Paschel, and I can report that from the very first conversation, bringing LAESER to UT was fundamental to his vision and to our vision. Marcelo is a major public intellectual in Brazil, who for two decades before coming here practiced the principles of pesquisa engajada in the best Latin American tradition of Paulo Freire, Beatriz Senabies Nascimento, Orlando Falsborda, Silvio Rivera Cusicanti, many, many, many more. Ads and Lilas are fortunate to have him and this project, both for its specific mandate and more generally because it exemplifies powerfully, as Reed mentioned in his introduction, it exemplifies powerfully how social science research can meet the highest scholarly ends while in complementary fashion support and accompany organizations in struggle for racial justice. So first off, parabéns, felicitaciones, congratulations. In my brief minutes, carefully controlled, I'd like to introduce you to another project, born and gestated in Lilas Benson, which has convergent objectives with those of LAESER. We started as a network of observatories on racism. The we was Julia Cooker, myself, and a number of others. The observatories were first in Bolivia, Guatemala, Colombia, later Mapuche, Historia de Comunidad Historia de Lores Mapuche, in Brazil, Organización Criolla. And very importantly, this, at least in this discussion, as Kristen made a reference to and others have as well, that the project had very importantly has a U.S. dimension as well. We started with organizations, and it also involved a lot of former students of this very institution, and also as was said in the introduction, Tianna Paschel has been working with us on this as well. It began as a network of observatories on racism, and through those discussions, eventually a research project emerged. Funds were run through LILAS as a seven country project. It's unwieldy, complicated, lots of drama, but it's an America's wide attempt to look at Black and Indigenous struggles against racism and strategies for racial equity. It's called RAYAR, the Red de Investigación y Acción Antirracista. One of the participants who works in the United States with the organization Black Lives Matter, Lee Mullings, a recently emeritus professor of anthropology here in the U.S. Leith and I wrote an overview chapter with what we call a relational analysis of these seven cases. And what I want to do here is offer two ideas that we highlight in that chapter. The first is a sobering observation that we're facing an emergent America-wide phase of racial capitalism, which we characterize as a project of racial retrenchment. And second is a remarkable systemic legitimation crisis, one key feature of which is a growing prominence of anti-racist resistance that employs what we're calling a use and refuse political strategies. Most of the book's authors have at least one foot in the academic world, and we want to exert influence in this realm. At the same time, from its inception, the project has been committed to the principles of activist scholarship. Research topics formulated, data collected and interpreted through horizontal dialogue with organized groups in struggle, analysis and conclusions that these same groups hopefully will recognize as useful and actionable. I remember clearly the moment when that dialogue produced the spark of what would become the central theme of the research project, which goes by the title, When Rights Ring Hollow. And looking back at it now, that moment also encapsulates the two ideas from our relational chapter that I'm going to talk about briefly. We were meeting in Bogota's office of the Afro-Colombian organization, as part of a three-day workshop on strategic litigation, how PSN uses the law to bolster resistance and advance emancipatory goals. The specific legal principle in question was the right of free and informed prior consent, or FPIC, crucial to defending their territories against extractivist exploitation. In the midst of his explanation of how they're crafting this strategic litigation with FPIC, PSN leader Carlos Rosero stopped abruptly to vent his anger. The Colombian state, having signed Convention 169 that gives Afro-Colombians the right to free prior informed consent, and then proceeded, he explained, to deploy one maneuver after another to limit its reach and efficacy. Carlos's outburst catalyzed a break in the planned agenda as participants from each of the seven countries offered their own examples of experiences that added fuel to the fire of that critique. It was not that states were actively retracting or withdrawing hard-fought rights, although that was also happening, but rather this cathartic break brought forth an image of these rights being hollowed out from within. That was 2014. Our initial framing of the research hypothesis suggested that the three-decade expansion of rights that indigenous and Afro-descendant peoples had achieved, both rights to equal citizenship and rights grounded in cultural difference, is coming to an end. We affirmed, of course, that these rights had serious limits from the start, by design and by their entanglement with neoliberal economic policies that deepened the basis of racial inequality faster and more effectively than any benefits the rights could confer. Yet still, these rights had been crucial instruments of struggle. They'd helped to take down governments in some cases. We hypothesized that in the face of this hollowing effect, indigenous and Afro-descendant movements would be obliged to forge new strategies of resistance, which in turn would offer diagnostics of the emergent forms of racism that they were confronting. That was 2014. We soon abandoned the language of a shift because it did not begin to capture the virulent America-wide lurch to the right that our seven research teams documented over the subsequent 3 years, a transformation that marks the emergence of a new racial project, an ugly project of racial retrenchment. Rights being hollowed out sounds relatively manageable, perhaps even reversing. By contrast, the keywords in the processes that our research chronicles are criminalization, mass incarceration, state-condoned and state-perpetrated assassination, rollback and active suppression of rights, accumulation through dispossession. While these patterns are fairly well known on a descriptive level, they're poorly understood analytically as more than a convergence of frightening trends. Our distinctive contribution is to place them in America's wide explanatory frame that views the emergent racial project as integral to, and in some respects a product of, the broader conditions of global racial capitalism. The term racial project has been around for a while, first developed famously by Omi and Winant to outline the major wave of backlash in the 1980s against achievements of the civil rights movement. Their definition is straightforward: an institutionally backed distribution of societal resources along racial lines, accompanied by ideological justifications that portray this distribution as normal, proper, and just. We use this concept to weave together four features of the emergent America's wide racial project, none of which is completely new, but each is markedly ascendant, and their convergence is potent and extraordinarily toxic. A rapidly deepening racially structured economic inequality is the first. Yes, this inequality batters societies across the board, I'll get to that in a moment, but no, it cannot be properly understood without highlighting its specific racial dimensions. Second, many, not all, but many working people of the dominant cultures, whites in the United States, mestizos in Latin America, who suffer from this deepening inequality, are being led to the broad conclusion that democracy is a sham that serves only the rich, corrupt, and powerful, and that the modestly expanding rights of racialized peoples in the last three decades is somehow to blame for their economic distress. Third, political economic elites actively foster and reap advantage from both these conclusions, portraying the active suppression of Black and Indigenous rights movements as just and necessary responses to the crisis. They've gone too far. Their identity politics have run amok. Fourth and finally, Black and Indigenous movements themselves have been weakened by these forces of change, especially the tendency for a small and relatively privileged sector to become distanced from the rest, with an excessive dependency on state-recognized rights and associated philanthropic beneficence, which undermines their inclination or ability to wage struggle against systemic oppression. This synthetic glimpse of the emergent racial project of racial retrenchment, dismal and grim as it may be, has a counterpart in two paired observations that are sources of mild, I emphasize mild, encouragement. First, we found novel strategies of resistance that mark potentialities, and at the same time are diagnostic, fleshing out our understanding of the new racial formation in the making. This resistance is grounded in a deepening skepticism of the assumption that victories in the struggle for state-recognized rights are compatible with Black and Indigenous freedom dreams. The apparent compatibility, mildly suspect in the previous era, now appears simply preposterous. How can we turn to the state for protection, Afro-Brazilians ask, when the state is a massive perpetrator of anti-Black violence? The counterpoint to state-recognized rights is some kind of self-determination, de facto, seized and defended through political struggle, bolstered by building bases of political economic power that do not have to ask the state's permission, that assert what our Mapuche colleagues call epistemological sovereignty. Among the seven sites of struggle, the Mapuche most adamantly defend this position, autonomy as radical refusal. Another element of this resistance, also very much present in our research, affirms the focus on self-determination and simultaneously works to occupy the more conventional spaces of political assertion, from elections to state-endorsed rights to judicial maneuver. At first glance, these two strategies appear to be diametrically opposed, one committed to the politics of radical refusal and the other to counter-hegemonic struggles from within. While internal debates of our research teams did at times bring this polarity to the fore, the more common conclusion came as protagonists began by acknowledging these boundaries and then intentionally blurring them, which yields this use and refuse sensibility with distinct strategic implications. Once an autonomous political horizon is firmly established as point of departure, it's easier to make tactical forays into the realm of state-endorsed rights and legal claims with less risk of being tempted by their neutralizing allure. And conversely, a decision to use the system in this instrumental way can provide welcome cover in the face of the wrath that radical refusal is apt to generate from the powers of being. We found instances of this combined use and refuse position throughout the seven sites of struggle, from the remarkable experience of Black political economic empowerment in Jackson, Mississippi, which is connected to the Black Lives Matter movement, documented in the recent book called Jackson Rising, to Mapuche movements to recover ancestral territory, which draw amply on state resources while refusing state authority. And there are other examples I won't go into. The second broad America's wide conclusion focuses on what Michael Dawson and many others, following Habermas and I think ultimately following Gramsci, call a legitimation crisis. The argument in short form is as follows. In order to legitimate systemic inequality, the state has to perform a certain amount of functions perceived to serve the well-being of the general population rather than solely the political economic elite. Across the region, across the Americas, that public trust is in tatters, to the point that liberal democracy itself and the associated regime of multicultural rights has been called fundamentally into question. While the Trump-Bolsonaro monsters are symptoms of this legitimacy crisis, so is Lopez Obrador, and so is the wave of resistance epitomized by the Black Indigenous mobilization that comprise the sites of struggle in our study. Profound systemic instability is scary, immensely threatening, but it also opens possibilities. To conclude, I pose, hopefully within my time, I propose two questions.
2 minutes and 30 seconds.
All right. Two questions which we've been working on and which have no easy answer. First, while this use and refuse position is fairly straightforward to describe in theoretical terms, it's extremely difficult to express and I think sustain as a collective political sensibility. Refusal breeds disdain for dominant institutions, which makes strategies for use hard to justify. Use conveys compliance that makes those committed to refusal risky. So how can this combined political strategy best be expressed and sustained? Second question focuses back on our own academic institutions, and I have to admit is somewhat prompted by my current work commitments. How to deploy university resources to nurture these vibrantly anti-racist spaces, even when the protagonists of these struggles ultimately seek autonomous political economic power and tend to turn away from, even actively critique, our efforts of incremental institutional change. For those who have chosen administrative paths in higher education, this question and its corollaries should continue to haunt us until we have better answers than I do right now. Thank you.
Thank you.
For inviting me. Everybody, I think, invited to this conference has acted as either formal mentors to me or informal mentors over time, and it really is an honor to be among all of you. This is a real difficult task I think we have in front of us, and for me, it's not just the fact that everyone here have written the books in English on Afro-Latin America, but also the moment that we're living in that has been already talked about by Daniela, especially in Charlie Hale, and also in Marcelo's opening comments. So as I prepared my presentation on data that's almost about 8 years old at this point, it actually drove home the imperative for us as academics to be more agile, more indignant, more activist, more urgent than we are, and more urgent than our institutions allow us to. So I hope this presentation gets us a little closer to that urgency, to that activist version of this work. So my research mainly has been interested in this so-called multicultural turn. It's been interested in mapping why Latin American states went from these decades-long denial of racism and the promotion of these citizenship regimes that relied on ideas of unmarked universal citizenship. I was also interested in the ways in which these different kinds of policies, which are really broad in terms of what they're trying to do, what the impact of these have actually been. So in my book, Becoming Black Political Subjects, I analyzed these changes in two countries that I believe have the most comprehensive reforms, at least in relation to black populations. And I argued that the specific policy adoption of policies for black populations in these two cases was not just a policy change, right? It marked a dramatic change in state discourse, as well as some transformation in state institutions, and at least formally how citizenship was defined in these countries. Nevertheless, as Charlie outlined, it did not naturally follow that these political changes would actually matter in the lives of ordinary people. And of course, all of these reforms have inherent limitations, even if they were fully implemented. There's also this notorious gap between laws on paper and actual state practices. As the popular Brazilian adage says, there are laws that stick and there are laws that don't, right? And the Colombian expression, I think, that's akin to this is, there are more laws than people in Colombia, which there are, of course. And there's this kind of widespread skepticism, of course, in the ability of the law itself to actually change deep entrenched patterns of anti-Black violence, of anti-Black racism. And so this all begged the question of the extent to which the adoption of specific policies for Black populations actually translated into real change on the ground. So in the book, I look at land reform and also affirmative action as some of the sites in which we can kind of analyze the extent to which these forms have had material impacts. And in terms of land reforms in both Colombia and Brazil, I chart out the kind of ways in which the institutions set up that are supposed to protect Black rights actually start to create these bureaucratic logics in the form of holdups and in the form of restricting definitions of Blackness, in the form of dissolving state institutions and creating new ones over and over and over again that really mask the racial capitalist nature of the retrenchment of Black rights, right? The fact that there are insatiable economic interests behind this, both domestic and transnational, that are interested in the land, in the territory, where Black movements have fought for and where they're supposed to live their lives according to at least the constitutions. And so we see this especially in Brazil, where even under the PT, the most abysmal ethno-racial policies are really around Quilombola land, that you have demarcation processes happening super slow, but even if you look at that demarcation, the amount of actual collective titles is really, really, really low. And so to kind of think about how these questions about who is a Quilombola and who is Black actually serve as cover to the deeper questions around who wants this territory and who is fighting for it both legally and extra legally. So even in this kind of formulation that I put together in the book, I was really concerned with mapping these kind of material effects of these new rights. And over the last few years, now that the book is out and I can kind of breathe away from the project, I've been thinking more about the material as a particularly restrictive way of thinking about what rights are and what rights do. So in this presentation, I'd like to offer a corrective to thinking about what they are and what they do. And I want to suggest that we think about the effects of ethno-racial reforms and more capaciously, not just in terms of what they purport to do, but what their unintended consequences are. What forms of productive power they have, what kinds of things do they produce, what kinds of reactionary politics do they unleash. And I think only then can we better understand the current moment and better theorize the relationship between social movements, the state, and racial projects. And so I'll first, I'll try to kind of chart this out by thinking a little bit about some examples. And then most of my presentation is really just me thinking aloud about what I think would be a research agenda if we were to take that kind of thing seriously and how we might think about what we might do going forward. So given the many challenges to the implementation of ethno-racial reforms, especially the territorial rights that I just spoke of, it may be easy to dismiss them as window dressing, as multiculturalism light, or as a re-articulation of racial hegemony, as Omi and Wanat might. But I want to posit a different reading of this moment that moves us towards thinking about Black rights not just in their fleeting nature, not just as a blip in Latin American history, but as productive of all kinds of things, right? Another way of putting it is really just what have Black rights produced if not the exercise of Black rights? And so the example of land rights in Colombia and Brazil, as well as the public drama that unfolded around affirmative action in Brazil and other so-called racialist policies, I think give us some clues about the productive power of these rights. First, there has been a shift in the relationship between the Black movement and the state. And I think for those of us who are studying contemporary Black movements, it's hard to kind of remember that when folks like Ali Johnson were doing their work, and when you look at some of the earlier accounts of Black movements, that there's a fundamentally different relationship in those periods, right? So there's been this reconfiguration. So if we compare the studies of the 80s and 90s, where certainly there was some movement of Black movements within political parties, but the limitations in the state were very clear, we see Black movements that were ignored, even laughed at. And this moves with the adoption of Black rights to this space in which they're legitimated, not in the sense that the state concedes actual power to them, but in the sense that Black activists become people that must be dealt with, right? They must be bought off, They must be persecuted, they must be jailed, they must be killed, they must be co-opted. And I think that this is actually an important difference between the previous moment and this moment. It is not just a rearticulation of anti-blackness. I think that the so-called multicultural turn actually reorients the state vis-a-vis movements, and of course produces a whole set of like crisis struggles for representation within the movement around what kind of strategy you have vis-a-vis this new partial problematic incorporation. Second and relatedly, there's what, again, a theorist who keeps coming up in this conversation, Afro-Colombian activist Carlos Rosero, calls new modalities of violence, right? And this is a pushback against the kind of arguments that people make that like the law of black communities or Ley 70 in Colombia actually produce violence. He wants to kind of say, no, that the violence has been a systemic nature of how the state, and particularly how transnational capital enters in black rural communities on the Pacific coast. But what happens with the new constitution is that the modality of violence shifts, right? Not just that there's violence. And I think one of the ways in which this modality of violence shifts is really this combination of the use of legal and extra legal violence to displace black communities, to persecute activists. And so it's not an exaggeration to say that this is perhaps one of the most deadly times to be a black or indigenous activist. And one could say human rights activists more generally in Latin America, and I should say black and indigenous. I think human rights activists is a little more complicated given certain histories of like dictatorship in Argentina, but certainly in the two countries that I work in, this is the time where activists are really scared, right? And this is as true, I think, in Colombia and Brazil as it is in Central America. And I think if we have doubts about what I just said, we only need to look at the assassination of Javier Franco, or the political incarceration of Sara Liliana Quiñones and her mother, Tulia Maris Valencia, who maybe today or around today are completing 6 months in jail right now for working for the defense of constitutionally recognized rights for black communities, and who have, under the guise of this peace accord, been made out to be sympathetic to the FARC, right, as a way of delegitimating black movement claims, right? So the third and final sort of effect of black rights that I want to talk about here today is around the politicization of racial identities, which I find to be the most like analytically interesting aspect of this, right? Which is both promising but also troubling if you're interested in things like racial equality or racial justice. And this is because race has become increasingly politicized, not just on one side, but on all sides of the societies in Latin America today. So arguably, the proliferation of policies for black populations and the increased mobilization of black organizations has led to these very public battles around racial identity, around how people define the nature of their societies. And arguably, they produce a generation of people who are not just thinking about race in new ways, but are consciously identifying themselves as black. And so a number of scholars have shown that the black movement and the shift to affirmative action in Brazil, for example, has meant more people identifying in these categories and more people talking about their blackness in politicized ways. You could do a whole social media analysis of how this plays out in blogs, on Twitter, and in various forms where Brazilians are representing, because they use social media more than everybody. And even Zuckerberg has feelings about that. So even Eddie Tejas and I have found that this kind of move towards increasingly identifying as black was true of black educated Brazilians, like kind of countering historic arguments about money whitening. Though we found that also that pattern also existed. Also in my book, I give the example of the Jolezinhos that occurred in 2013 and 2014 as these instances of black and brown youth, mostly from favelas and suburbios around Brazil, taking over public space, and often with a discourse that included both a class critique and a race critique, right? As this moment of kind of expansion of a politicized black identity. I paid much less attention to the other politicized identity that was also emerging in this period. And that is the identity of politicized white nationalism, especially in the case of Brazil, but arguably also in the case of Colombia. Whiteness has come out in Brazil, so to speak. I'd argue that it has been compelled to express itself in unprecedented ways through discourses of patriotism, of course, but discourses that remind us of the linkages between whiteness as a state project and the security apparatus and anti-black racial projects. So affirmative action is where this begins to start, with all of the ideas of like todos somos iguales, na república, all the invocations of Martin Luther King, because you must quote Martin Luther King when you try to systematically crush racial projects or anti-racist projects, you must quote him. And these overt linkages between whiteness and patriotism have a kind of interesting appropriation of leftist repertoires of protest. So you see these ludic versions, which I think I'll talk about a little later, this like appropriation of the left in terms of how you move on the streets and what protest looks like. So what I'd like to really end by talking about is what our research agenda might look like in this terrifying moment across the Americas. And the first point is really whiteness, 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 branquitude, branquitude, branquitude. I'm not sure in Spanish is it branquitude. I don't even know how people don't say it very often because of the prominence of mestizo nationalism. But I think, you know, we can think about what the mestizo equivalent would be of this as well. So I think that if we are to actually study whiteness, 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 this would mean being itself, but to think more about the architecture, the habitus, the logic, and the